We've looked at how we can use bar graphs and pie charts to display one-way data. And in this video, I want to talk about two other ways to display that kind of data, line graphs and ogives. And we're going to go ahead and start with line graphs. We've already used this example where we've created a bar chart out of data about the Summer Olympic Games. We counted up the number of times each continent has hosted the Summer Olympics and used that data to create a bar chart, and this is what it looked like. The reason I'm bringing up a bar graph is because a bar graph is really similar to a line graph, and we can turn one into the other and vice versa. So if we wanted to turn this bar graph into a line graph, all we need to do is plot a point at the top middle of each bar. So that would look like this. We just come to the top of each bar, right in the middle, and we sketch a point. So we know Europe has hosted the Summer Olympics 16 times, so right up here at 16, we plot a point. North America has hosted the Summer Olympics 6 times, so right here at 6, we plot a point, and so on. So we have a point at the top of each bar, and then all we have to do is connect those points with straight lines. So we connect one point to the next with a straight line, then this point to the next with a straight line, then this point to the next with a straight line, and so on until we've connected all the points. Then if we just remove the bars that are left over from our bar graph, this suddenly is a line graph. So this is what a line graph looks like, and as you can see, it's really the same as a bar graph, except that instead of displaying the data with bars, we display the data with points connected by lines. Now you might be wondering, if bar graphs and line graphs are so similar, when is it appropriate to use a bar graph, and when is it more appropriate to use a line graph? Well, line graphs are typically better when there's some kind of a connection between the data points. So for example, when you have change over time, if you want to graph data every hour in the course of a day or every month of the year, something like that. So moving through time and there's a connection between the points. Or if somehow these aren't really discrete categories and they're connected together, it feels like there should be a flow, then a line graph is a good choice. But if these categories here, the individuals that we graph along the bottom, are discrete and don't really have anything to do with each other necessarily, then a bar graph is usually the better choice. So in fact, this graph here of how often each continent has hosted the Summer Olympics is probably better as a bar graph rather than a line graph, so we'll go ahead and change that back. On the other hand, something like the monthly average high temperature in Scottsdale, Arizona, is going to be better as a line graph because it shows change over time. So as we move through a calendar year from January to February to March, etc., we're showing change over time of temperature, and it's more interesting for us to see the connection between these individual months. So instead of doing this as a bar graph, it makes a little more sense to do it as a line graph. But again, to be fair, we could still do this as a bar graph. It would still make sense that way as well. But let's go ahead and do this as a line graph. So the first thing we want to see is that our lowest temperature is down here in December at 68 degrees, and the highest temperature is here in July at 105 degrees. So if we want to sketch this as a line graph, we need to put in our horizontal lines here to indicate the intervals, and we need to cover at least from 68 degrees to 105. So we could go ahead and sketch in something like this, where we start at 0, which is well below 68, and we go up to 110 to make sure we encompass the highest value. Then we would want to go ahead and along the bottom here, write out the months January through December before we go in and plot points. So here we have January, February, March, April, May, June, July, etc., all the way through to December. Now to create the line graph, all we have to do is plot individual points. So January is 69 degrees. We could go ahead and come up here from January just above 66 and plot a point there. And if we do that for each month, we see here a plot of the average high temperature in each month. So we do in fact see 69 degrees for January, right up above 66. February is 73, so it's a little higher. July, 105, which is the hottest month, is all the way up here, just below 110. So we plot our points first, and then we go ahead and just connect each of those points with a straight line. So we don't draw a smooth curve, we draw a straight line in between each point, and that looks like this. We said before that it's nice to use a line graph when there's some kind of connection between the data points, between the individuals, as opposed to a bar graph when that connection isn't as strong. And here's one of the reasons why. When we have a line graph, it's really easy for us to see the slope or the rate of change between data points. So for example, I could look at this section of my line graph right here, which is the change in temperature between June and July. So as we move from June to July, because this line is slightly sloped upward, I can conclude that the temperature rises from June to July. So July is hotter than June. The temperature creeps up slightly. I can say slightly because the line doesn't have a very steep slope. It's pretty gradual. And in fact, if I look here at my table, I can see that June is about 103 degrees, July is 105. So it is a gradual slight increase from June to July. But if I contrast that with this section of the graph right here, which is the change between September and October, I can see that the line segment connecting September to October is not only negatively sloped, where this line segment was positively sloped, but it's also much steeper versus this slope is much more shallow. So what I can say is that from September to October, the temperature is dropping, it's getting colder, and it drops at a much more significant rate. The change in temperature from September to October is much greater than the change in temperature from June to July. And if I look back at my table, I can see that. From September to October, I drop 11 degrees. 100 minus 89 is 11, so I drop 11 degrees, whereas from June to July, I gained 2 degrees. So just plus 2 versus minus 11, this is a much greater drop. And I can see that reflected in my line graph because the slope of the line is steeper here and more shallow here. Now, an ogive is really similar to a line graph. It looks just like a line graph, but you can think of it as an accumulated line graph. So for instance, let's say I have this table here. Let's say it shows your age from age 30 to age 39 and the investment that you make into a retirement account each year. So let's say at age 30, you invested $5,500. At age 31, you invested another $5,500. At age 32, another $5,500, and you keep doing that until you're 39. This is an interesting table in the sense that you can see your investment each year, but it would be even more interesting to see not only the investment you made each year, but your accumulated total. So if I modify this table and I add in your accumulated total, I see now that after the first year, you've invested $5,500 and your total is $5,500. In the second year at age 31, you invest an additional $5,500, so I see that investment that year. But I can also see that your accumulated total is now $5,500 plus $5,500 is $11,000. And I can see that each year you add $5,500, and I can see that the total increases until eventually, after 10 years, you have a $55,000 total. Now, let me just say for a second that normally when you say investment, you're talking about putting in some kind of investment amount like the $5,500 and then getting some kind of an interest return on that investment. In this example, we're just talking about the invested amount. We're ignoring any interest that you would gain from that investment. So I just want to look at the amount that we invest and then the accumulation of that invested amount over time. This kind of data is perfect to graph in an ogive, because an ogive allows you to show this accumulated total here. So let's see what that looks like. First of all, I know that I'm starting at 5,500, I'm gonna end up at 55,000. So I would wanna go ahead and plot my lines here and then plot my ages from age 31 to 39, and then go ahead and on the left-hand side here, say I'm starting at 0, and I know I'm going up to 55, so I'm gonna need my axis to come up to maybe $60,000 so I can capture all of the data in my chart. Then instead of plotting the investment each year, because if I simply plotted 5,500 for each year, I would have a straight horizontal line somewhere around here, just straight across at the bottom of the graph, showing a $5,500 investment each year. That really wouldn't be very interesting. But if I plot the accumulated totals, then I would see actually the accumulation and my money growth over time. So I would say here that at age 30, I invested $5,500, so my total was $5,500. At age 31, I made an additional investment, and now my total is $11,000, so I plot the $11,000. At age 32, I made an additional investment, now my total is $16,500, so I plot that point $16,500 right above $15,000 here. So basically, I'm plotting the total every year, not just the investment. And when I connect these with straight lines, again, a straight line between every point, now I have an ogive, because the ogive is showing the accumulated total over time. It shows me that by age 33, I have maybe about 20,000. It shows me that at age 39, I have something around $55,000 because I'm showing the accumulated total of the money that I'm saving. Notice here that for the line graph that we did for temperature, so we have up here the line graph, it wouldn't make sense at all to do this as an ogive, because we would be adding temperatures together every month. So January would be 69 degrees, February would be 69 plus 73 is 142 degrees, March would be over 200 degrees, etc. And that doesn't make any sense. We would just have constant rising temperature. Temperature is not a good variable to graph as an ogive. It makes sense in a line graph where we see change over time. But savings over time is great in an ogive. We'll go ahead and say that this is our ogive. Savings over time is great in an ogive because it allows me to see my accumulated savings over time. And it also allows me to see the rate of my investment. So the reason that this is a perfect line is because my investment stays constant over the entire decade from age 30 to 39. I invest $5,500 each year, so my rate of investment is always the same. If my rate of investment changed and I invested a different amount each month, then the slopes of these lines would be different. We might have something instead that looks like this. I could have invested much more, and then maybe a little bit less that year, and then invested a little bit more, and then not quite as much this year, but then a lot this year, and then a lot the next year, and then a little bit less. And so I would be seeing my accumulated savings, and I would also be able to see the rate of change of my savings. So in these years, I invested a lot and my savings grew more quickly. In these years, like here and here and here, I invested less, and so my savings didn't grow quite as fast. And then when we have this linear relationship, it tells us that our saving rate is constant. So just remember that bar graphs are best for representing data that isn't necessarily connected, more categorical data that doesn't need to be tied together in any way. A line graph is really, really great for representing change over time, so that we can see how one variable moves up and down, and the rate of change between each data point. An ogive is best when you want to show an accumulated total. Not only can you see rate of change between each data point, but you also get the bonus of seeing the accumulation over time, so you're kind of getting two pieces of information in one graph, and so an ogive really makes sense when you want to show both of those things at the same time, a great example of which is showing your savings over time, so that you can see not only your year-to-year savings rate, but also the total amount of savings that you've accumulated.